appalling abuse of at least 1,400 children over a period of 16 years.
This week, allegations of a paedophile ring engulfed Westminster.
Former Lost Prophet singer Ian Watkins has been jailed for 35 years for a string of child sex offences.
Paedophiles, it seems, are everywhere in Britain today. And almost every week, a new child sex abuse scandal breaks. Predatory paedophiles operating at every level of society have abused our children with impunity. For over 50 years, they've made a mockery of the elaborate policies put in place to protect our children. And the well-known cases are only the tip of the iceberg. The system isn't working, and I want to know why. My name's Steve Humphries. I'm a historian and documentary filmmaker, and I care deeply about child protection. I was one of the first to break the story of sexual abuse in the Catholic Church back in the 1990s. To find out how we can effectively protect our children today, I'll be exploring the secret underworld of paedophiles.
Tell us where he is!
And meeting survivors of some of the most harrowing sexual abuse imaginable.
To me, abuse become normal. I knew nothing from 3 years of age, from what I remember. Abuse, 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 abuse.
I'll be hearing from controversial experts who believe we need to completely rethink our attitudes towards paedophiles.
At the moment, the only message that they're hearing from us in society is, you're a paedophile, you're an evil monster, we hate you. And that's not a deterrent, it doesn't keep kids safe.
And amazingly, I'll come face to face with a paedophile who comes out on camera. To keep our children safe, we need to understand much more about paedophiles, because the evidence suggests they're all around us. If anyone knows the true scale of paedophilia in Britain today, then it's Jonathan Taylor. For years, he was Scotland Yard's paedophile hunter, entrapping would-be predators online.
The problem is just getting bigger and bigger and bigger. We identified it 10 years ago, it was an epidemic scale. And yet, still today, we're talking about, well, what should we do about it? That's wrong.
Jonathan wanted to show me how many men are out there looking to groom our children. As bait, he logged into a popular chat room, pretending to be a 13-year-old girl.
And I've put here a female named Becky, 13, indicating an age, and UK meaning where I'm from.
It was just an ordinary Thursday afternoon, but after a few seconds, the fictitious 13-year-old Becky began to get messages from men online.
But this one here asking what I look like. This one happy to give his name.
We'd only been online for a couple of minutes when the messages began to turn much darker.
I like young women, has gone, he fingered you yet. So now we get into the inappropriate sexual chat. Right, he's now told me a site where you upload pics, www. Now I know that it's a Russian site that contains indecent images of children.
Just 7 minutes in and we got the first message suggesting a meeting.
This one here, Midlands, shame I'm looking to meet up tonight. Bear in mind, he now knows me as a Becky, a 13-year-old girl.
And still they poured in. I was appalled to think that each one was sent by a potential child sexual abuser. It looked like the problem was out of control, and Jonathan agreed.
We're a long way from dealing with it properly. Long way. In my opinion, we haven't even got in the boat to go and see the tip of the iceberg. That's what sort of epidemic this is.
Recent estimates of the number of paedophiles in Britain range widely between around 50,000 and a staggering 250,000. To understand the human cost of child sexual abuse, I wanted to meet someone who'd actually experienced it. I've come to meet Sarah Forsyth, who has a harrowing story to tell.
Hi, Sarah.
Sarah was born in Gateshead in 1976, but by her late teens had become a drug-addicted prostitute, working the windows in Amsterdam's red light district. Her abuse began when she was just 3 years old.
looking back over the photos of me being a child, you get the impression that your childhood memories, you're happy, you should be smiling, laughing. All my photos, I look quite sad, to be honest. But as a child, he was my father. So you tend to listen, don't you? He was my father.
Did you tell anybody about what he was doing to you?
He said it's our secret. This is our little thing, you know, so, like, he tried to make me feel as if I was special to him. What he used to do was, he'd shout me in the bedroom and he'd, like, be, like, touching himself. And, like, I felt uncomfortable, so I used to, like, go to the bedroom and the bathroom. He used to, still touch himself, chases in the bedroom, bathroom, and then when he ejaculated, he's just like grip us and like keep us there and say watch, and like he's just squirt all over us. And that as a child, and then.
Sarah's story is a tragic reminder that child sexual abuse often happens behind the closed doors of ordinary people's homes.
Most child sexual abuse does happen within the family or within the extended family. A certain proportion of it will be by strangers, but estimates within the UK and international estimates are up there in the kind of 70-80% happening within the family or within the extended family.
That's why it's so hard for the police to stop it. So to do something about it, we may have to consider some radical new approaches. Dr. Sarah Good used to be a senior university lecturer and researcher specializing in paedophilia. She believes she lost her job because her ideas were so controversial. She now runs a small holding in the West Country. I've come to meet Dr. Good to find out more about her research.
Hi, Sarah, I'm Steve.
Steve, nice to meet you. Come on in.
I began by asking her how widespread she thinks the problem is today.
The statistics on child sexual abuse are 1 in 6 children will be sexually abused before the age of 16. That breaks down into 1 in 4 girls and roughly 1 in 8 boys. When you think about statistics like that, what we're talking about really is an epidemic.
Dr. Good was convinced that the best way to keep children safe was to understand paedophiles. So she tried to contact them directly and logged on to online forums where paedophiles congregate.
When I started the research, I think I was like anybody else. I just thought, oh, paedophiles, horrible. They harm children. How can we solve this problem? So I put out questionnaires and I got a whole community sample of men to answer it. So this was the first time, really, that research has been done on paedophiles who are not offenders, they're not in prison and they're not in treatment. They're not known to anybody. And one of the things that I found really baffling was that within the paedophile community, there is this group of men, we don't know how many, we don't know what proportion they are, but men who are committed to living a law-abiding lifestyle, and that they are very clear that they will not harm children. And that's a new thing, we didn't know that before, that's a completely hidden population.
The discovery of this hidden community of so-called virtuous paedophiles led Dr. Good to the conclusion that we need to think differently about paedophilia.
At the moment, what we do is we think about paedophiles, we assume that they're going to be child sex offenders, okay? Those two terms are pretty much interchangeable. So where does that leave you if you yourself are sexually attracted to children? What are you supposed to do? How are you supposed to live your life?
Come on, come on, come on.
Dr. Good explained that instead of demonizing all paedophiles, we should encourage as many as possible to seek help before they become offenders, and as a result, reduce the number of children who were sexually abused. It's a bold idea, but I was skeptical. Are there really paedophiles out there who are able to control their sexual feelings towards children? To find out, I asked Dr. Good whether one of the men she'd met online would talk to me on camera. Amazingly, one agreed. So now, I'm on my way to meet a paedophile. I'm on a mission to find out the truth about paedophiles, and the best way to do that is to meet one. So I'm on my way to see a self-confessed paedophile called Eddie, who claims he's never acted on his attraction to children. It's hard to know for certain if that's true, but a police check confirmed there was no record of any criminal convictions. Most of us would never dream of talking to a paedophile, but if it can help keep our children safe, I think it's worth doing. Eddie had a fairly normal childhood. He was popular at school, good at sport, and even became captain of the school rugby team. It all seemed very ordinary. So would meeting him reveal anything else?
Hi, Eddie. How are you doing?
Good to meet you.
Come on in.
Thank you. Tell me how you came to recognise that you were a paedophile.
When I basically in my mid-20s, I'm now 39, and in my mid-20s, it was a difficult time because that was when I first realised, well, I wouldn't say first realised, but came to the conclusion that it was fair to say that I am a paedophile. The thing is, it's not the only thing I am, but it plays a large part in the makeup of who I am as a person. I'd much prefer not to have these feelings and these attractions, but I have them, and that's difficult.
Tell me about that.
I have an age of attraction that starts, depending on the individual, as low as 5, roughly. 4 or 5, 6. A lot of people automatically assume that because I think or feel that way, that I'm potentially going to abuse a child, which in my mind has never been something that I don't feel I'm capable of that kind of thing. I certainly don't want to do that kind of thing. For me, it's perhaps not so difficult because I'm not exclusively attracted to children, because I do find myself attracted to women. Of all ages.
While it was uncomfortable to hear Eddie talk so openly about his sexual attraction to young girls, I was surprised to find out that he's also attracted to women. In fact, this sort of non-exclusive sexual attraction is typical of many paedophiles. That's why so many are married with children who pass unnoticed in our communities. The truth is, they just seem like ordinary men. But given our very understandable fear of paedophiles and the current hatred towards them, I wondered why Eddie had decided to take the extraordinary step of coming out on camera.
People will probably say, why isn't this guy locked up? We should kill this guy. We should go and give him a good shoeing. Well, I honestly, God, I will not run away from you. And if that's what you want to do to me, then you come and do it, because all you're doing in that scenario is just keeping the status quo. Going around abusing children is not acceptable. Viewing images of child pornography is not acceptable. But people are just waiting for you to offend before they help you. And they're saying, well, if do what you want, but if we catch you, we're going to bang you up. Instead of saying, perhaps, listen, we can help you. But if you don't have that help, if you don't have the option to come forward and say, look, I've got a problem, I need help, what are we changing? We're changing nothing.
I'm not sure whether Eddie's decision to come out in this way is brave or reckless. In the current climate, he really is putting himself in danger by doing this. But Dr. Sarah Good thinks that his call for help has great significance.
Somebody who realizes that they are a paedophile has to make a choice about how they're going to live their lives. And at the moment, the only message that they're hearing from us in society is, you're a paedophile, you're an evil monster, we hate you, you're going to go and sexually abuse and probably rape and murder children. And there's nothing you can do about it because you are a paedophile, you're going to do that stuff. And when you do that stuff, we're going to lock you up in prison, you're going to have a terrible time in prison, everybody's going to hate you. Tough luck. And that's the only message that we're giving at the moment. And that's not a deterrent, it doesn't keep kids safe. Because it's not saying that that person has any choice. Now, if we change that message, and if we say to this person, okay, you're a paedophile, but you are also a moral person who can make moral choices, and you can choose never to break the law, never to offend. You can choose to keep children safe.
Meeting Eddie, I wondered what made someone a paedophile. One of the most common theories is the cycle of abuse, where those abused as children grow up to become abusers themselves.
That's not to say that, you know, all people who have experienced sexual abuse go on to become offenders themselves. Of course they don't. But a certain proportion of people who do perpetrate these awful crimes do have histories of neglect, of physical abuse, and of course of sexual abuse as well.
Eddie wasn't abused, but there may be another explanation. The latest scientific research is suggesting that paedophilia could stem from a difference in the wiring of some people's brains, and the process is likely to start in the womb. The causes of paedophilia are still debated, but the effects are the same.
We have to face the fact that there are people who have pedophilic sexual interests, who are interested in having sex with children. That's something we don't like. Most people don't like that, but it's a fact. And in that sense, it's a handicap. And you can compare it, I try to compare it to, yeah, having diabetes. You know, it also, it doesn't go away. You have to deal with it.
So how do we deal with it? As a historian, I know that paedophiles have always been amongst us, even going back to ancient Greece. And the truth is, in Britain, we've never really dealt with it. Despite the high morals proclaimed by the Victorians, we know there was significant child sex abuse in Britain from the late 19th up to the mid-20th century. It was kept secret because this was an era when children were largely seen and not heard. The NSPCC started campaigning on this issue over 100 years ago.
At that time, incest, as it was known, child sexual abuse, tended to be seen as a problem of moral degeneracy, largely speaking, as a problem within lower class, working class or poorer families. Any notion that sexual abuse was being perpetrated in middle or upper class families, in boarding schools or anything like that really wasn't recognised, although of course we know now it was indeed going on.
There's nothing new about paedophilia, but I believe the particular problems we face today have their roots in the 1960s and 70s. In amongst all the good things brought by the sexual revolution, a dangerous new group emerged. They called themselves the Paedophile Information Exchange, or PIE for short, and wanted sex with children to be legalized. They'd even have the gall to argue their case on Newsnight.
A child is able to recognise a pleasurable experience. He is able to recognise a pleasing emotional experience. He is able to express consent and to recognise that this is something he wishes to continue. And a responsible, caring paedophile, it always refers to the wishes of the child.
PIE enabled paedophiles to get organised. And it wasn't just information they exchanged.
These men were paedophiles seeking other paedophiles. PIE published a magazine, Magpie, and later its members published another magazine called Minor Problems. Both of these magazines served as contact points for paedophiles. They served as a way for paedophiles to exchange child pornography and in some cases locate children to abuse.
In what now seems like a moment of madness, Pi was actually taken seriously. They submitted evidence to a Home Office inquiry regarding the age of consent laws and were linked to the National Council for Civil Liberties at a time when Harriet Harman and Patricia Hewitt were senior members.
If today an organisation had said, men should be free to have sex with children at whatever age and we're campaigning for this, they would be howled down. They would not be allowed anywhere near the corridors of power and influence. Pi was.
Because of Pi's success, paedophiles helped each other to infiltrate our institutions and gain access to our children, especially in schools and residential care homes, making the problem even worse. So what did we do to try and stop it? And why didn't it work?
For many children, child sexual abuse is like a bomb going off deep underground. You can't see anything necessarily on the surface, but there's been this huge psychic damage and the repercussions last for years.
In 1988, it was discovered that Sarah Forsyth was being abused by her father, so she was removed from her family home and taken into care. She should have been safe there, but the care home she was sent to had been infiltrated by paedophiles.
They were able to do what they wanted, and that's what they did. Basically, did what they wanted. As a child, after everything I went through, I wanted safety. And they put me in a place, another place, where I was getting abused. I'd hold the tears back as much as it hurt us. And I'd never cry. He'd go, "Go on, cry, little bastard, go on." But I never used to ever let them see us cry. It always hurt us. Of course it hurt us. But you got used to it, didn't you?
It's heartbreaking to hear that as a vulnerable child, Sarah was sent to such a dangerous place. But the truth is that children were vulnerable across all levels of British society, even those from privileged backgrounds. I'm on my way to meet a man who was abused as a child back in the 1970s, a survivor of a paedophile ring that operated at Caldecott School in Buckinghamshire. Ian McFadyen was enrolled at Caldecott School in 1975.
Hi, Ian, I'm Steve.
Hi, Steve. Nice to meet you. Come on in, please.
It took him over 30 years to talk about what happened there.
I was very proud to attend Caldecott. I wore my school uniform with pride, even though what was going on behind closed doors was horrific.
George Hill was the deputy headmaster, a charismatic figure who was well liked by Ian's parents.
He was this person who was a very gentle character, almost grandfatherly type of figure. He's somebody who you warmed to and you trusted. The doors were always kind of open between the bathroom and his study. And one day he came in and explained that I had to clean underneath the head of my penis. And he soaped up and he cleaned me. And so the dance began.
Mr. Hill arranged to bath Ian once a week, and his contact with him gradually became more sexual.
There was nurturing, there was conversation, there was tenderness initially, and it's something that I wanted and was involved in. So, as an abuser, I had potentially been beautifully groomed and felt wholly complicit in this. It progressed to the level where Mr. Hill sodomized me. And I thought everyone would know because I could hardly walk. And this occurred over several years. I had gone to Caldecott, this happy little boy who people wanted to be around and liked and was honorable and was, you know, somebody of worth. And they take that from you.
I'm learning a painful truth that trusted adults like Mr. Hill are, next to family members, the most likely to groom and sexually abuse our children. I've seen the damage done by paedophiles in the 70s and 80s. So what did we do to try to stop them? The first major initiative to help children who were being sexually abused was Childline, launched by Esther Ranson in 1986. It broke new ground in child protection, empowering children to report sexual abuse to trained counselors 24 hours a day. On its very first night in operation, a staggering 55,000 attempted calls were made to the switchboard. I've got great admiration for what Childline does to offer a lifeline to vulnerable children. It clearly makes a big difference, but we can't just rely on our children to report sexual abuse because it's so difficult for them to reveal the truth.
Very often offenders will try to ensure that the child doesn't tell, not only by threats, but often with a process of rewarding the child as well. For the child to make sense of that confusion is incredibly, incredibly difficult, and that leads to the child very often making the decision not to say anything.
In the 80s, in response to growing public concerns, it was shown that taking a more proactive approach can work. The paedophile information exchange had always attracted protests, and in 1984, it was finally shut down after many of their senior figures were arrested. More paedophiles were jailed in the years that followed, as the police and social services took more concerted action on the increasing number of reports of child sexual abuse. After her release from care, Sarah Forsyth testified in court against her abusive father. He was sentenced to 8 years imprisonment.
Basically, all 12 members of the jury had found him guilty. And that was on my 29th of January, on my 16th birthday. Best birthday present I could ever wish for, because I knew I was safe. He was gone out of my life.
In some prisons, treatment programs were offered to the highest risk sex offenders. But these courses were voluntary, and many refused to take part. It was a mistake, because they'd soon be back on our streets. Meanwhile, the victims were living with the traumatic consequences of their sexual abuse. Before he'd even reached his teenage years, Ian McFadyen had been abused by a number of teachers at his boarding school, and he began to go off the rails.
First time I took heroin, I was 12, you know? First time I had my stomach pumped for alcohol poisoning, I couldn't have been any older than 13. 13, 14, I was jumping on trains from Reading into London. I was offering myself to men and groups of men. And I was engaging in really risk-taking sexual behavior. I had no regard for anybody else. I had no regard for myself. I didn't care whether I lived or died.
By the 1990s, there was another growing threat to our children, child pornography. At Scotland Yard, Jonathan Taylor spent 10 years in a team combating this new problem.
The first thing we actually saw were indecent images of children, which we just weren't ready for. And it was a shock to see these horrific pictures, images of children as young as newborn, up to 18, who were being sexually abused. And these movies would have sound, and there's nothing worse than hearing the sound of a very, very young child being raped.
In 1990, investigative journalist Tim Tate wrote the first book to lift the lid on the horrors of child porn.
Child pornography is, I think, a difficult and misleading term because people take the wrong inference from this. They hear the word pornography and they think a softcore spread, just a picture. What we're talking about is not pornography. It is the visual record of sexual assaults on babies and children.
During his research, Tim sat through hours of some of the most appalling footage imaginable.
And people said, well, how can you do this? How can you deal with this day in and day out? And my answer was very simple. It makes me angry.
Tell us where he is!
Across Britain, parents and local residents were angry too, when attempts were made to rehabilitate convicted sex offenders into the community. The people of Yeovil were horrified when it was rumoured that recently released child killer Sidney Cook had ended up in their town, and who can blame them?
We want him to go because he can pinch people and kill people.
These protests highlighted the growing problem that we didn't know what to do with sex offenders who'd served their sentences. And understandably, nobody wanted them living near their children. These fears would come to a head with the rape and murder of 8-year-old Sarah Payne in 2000 by known sex offender Roy Whiting. A subsequent campaign by the News of the World to print the names and addresses of convicted paedophiles led to mass protests. Incredibly, 20 were said to live on this estate in Portsmouth alone. Little wonder the people were angry.
There's too many. Too many of them. We don't want them around our kids.
The children of Paul's Grove are being robbed of their childhood because they cannot live as children should do freely.
As a result of these protests, many potentially dangerous paedophiles were forced from their homes and moved away to other parts of the country. It seemed like a victory for people power.
He's now gone. If we can just get things back to normal, they won't go home now.
However, unwittingly, the protesters were simply driving these offenders underground. And as the authorities no longer knew where they lived, they couldn't keep an eye on them. According to experienced police profiler Professor Karina de Reuter, this may have made them more dangerous and likely to offend.
We know for a fact that stress increases the risk of abuse in sexual offenders, including pedophiles. So if people are cornered, they can't go anywhere, they may resort to the kind of, behaviors that we do not want them to resort to.
While we were driving out the sex offenders we knew about, what about the many thousands of paedophiles we didn't know? What were they thinking? Paedophile Eddie knows only too well what it feels like from the inside.
I came to the conclusion that I was a paedophile through the use of pornography. And when I began to realise the implications of what I'd been looking at, I began to really question myself, and I was genuinely distressed and worried. So
why? Tell me more about that.
I think partly because at the time Sarah Payne had just been murdered and raped and murdered. I think it was Roy Whiting, wasn't it? So there was understandably a hysteria, and they immediately assumed that every paedophile is a rapist, and because everybody's making that jump and automatically assuming that you're going to do something bad. I internalized that. I thought I was a bad person. I thought that somewhere along the lines I'm going to do something.
It is in such circumstances that paedophiles like Eddie are most likely to act against a child or against themselves.
And at that time, I honestly was just thinking more and more about suicide. I couldn't escape it. It was never far from my mind. Many people would probably say, well, why didn't you do it? Just do us all a favor. Well, it was my life. I wanted it to mean something. Except nobody wanted to listen to me. Because whenever I've tried to talk to people about that, people won't listen. People will automatically assume that you will, at some point, abuse a child. And there's no way of helping you.
Having listened to Eddie, I realised that we really do need a new approach to this problem. Because if there was support available for paedophiles when they needed it, it could help to protect our children, which is something we all want. Whatever mistakes we've made in the past, it seems to me that we must act now to protect the next generation of children. So what new things can we do to help keep them safe? On my journey, I've learnt how damaging and widespread paedophilia is in Britain today. If we're going to tackle it, we need to try a range of new strategies. Scotland Yard's ex-paedophile hunter believes we should start with online safety at home.
Really, we should be doing far more about letting parents know that whatever happens, wherever their child goes on the internet, whatever device they use, however they're connected, be there with them. Spend that time with your child to understand their world. Their real world now is an online world.
While parents can take the initiative with education, survivors can also play their part. Today, Sarah Forsyth is training to be a social worker so that she can use her experience of abuse to identify children at risk.
My ultimate job is to protect a child. I wasn't protected, so I'm going to make damn sure I'll protect a child when I do my job, and I'm a qualified social worker, and I know I'll do that. And I know I'll do that.
But we also need to consider some more radical approaches to sex offenders themselves. One new idea is called Circles. It's a community scheme where volunteers monitor the behaviour of released paedophiles, offering them support to prevent them re-offending. It claims a 70% success rate.
We have to talk to paedophiles. We have to listen to paedophiles. However unpleasant what they may have to say is, we have to listen and we have to understand.
At the moment, we only engage with paedophiles after they've become offenders. But if talking works, wouldn't it be better to do it before paedophiles act on their desires? Because that would mean fewer victims.
Schon früh habe ich gemerkt, dass ich anders ticke. War schon klar,
wie man über solche wie mich denkt.
Krank.
Encouraging paedophiles to come out and seek help is already being done in Germany.
Durch die Therapie habe ich gelernt, niemand ist schuld an seiner sexuellen Neigung.
Aber jeder verantwortlich für sein Verhalten. Ich will kein Täter werden.
These are adverts for a groundbreaking prevention scheme called Dunkelfeld, which offers paedophiles residential courses of counselling and treatment. It sounds radical, but it's so successful, even the NSPCC believe it's a positive development.
It's important to recognise that people, you know, whether they're paedophiles or people with a sexual interest in children, that's a real problem for them. And, you know, what we're interested in at the NSPCC is that they receive help and advice and assistance so as they don't act on those feelings, so they don't act on those desires, and they therefore don't sexually harm, they don't sexually abuse children.
Survivor Ian McFadyen agrees. It wasn't until 2014 that the last of the teachers who formed the paedophile ring at Caldecott School was finally imprisoned. Deputy Headmaster George Hill, who'd abused Ian in the 1970s, committed suicide before he could be brought to justice. Today, with the support of his wife Paula, Ian has worked to rebuild his life. He's clear about what he thinks needs to be done to help keep children safe.
It's a really uncomfortable subject, sexual abuse. People don't really want to discuss it. I watch people irk when I discuss it. But I tell you what, if we don't talk about it, less children will be protected. And I can tell you this, it may be uncomfortable to talk about, but as somebody who has survived that, it's far less uncomfortable than actually the act being perpetrated on you.
To show how serious he is about the need to talk, Ian agreed for me to arrange a meeting between him and paedophile Eddie.
Hey.
Hi.
How you doing?
I'm Ian.
How you doing, Ian? I'm Eddie.
Good. Have a seat, man.
Thank you.
Have a seat.
I'm really, really happy that you wanted to meet. I'm surprised you wanted to meet, but I'm really happy you did.
18 years ago, to be quite honest with you, I think I would have assaulted you, and that's horrendous to admit. And 18 years ago, I was quite violent. I probably would have attempted to kill you.
Look, I'll say to you now, Ian, I've been completely honest with people about my attraction to children. Mm-hmm. I can't help that.
Yes.
Me personally, I wouldn't want to be that way.
Yes.
And when I first realised that I was sexually attracted to children, it was really distressful.
You don't need to know about the ins and outs of my life. I understand what it's like to be labelled, but what is a social no-no in society, and you'll know this better than I do, is to come forward and say that you're sexually attracted to children.
And then because of that,
yes,
these people are forced to live in the shadows.
Yes.
And they're forced to cope with it on their own. For me, obviously, there needs to be a support network for those people that are abused as children. Mm-hmm. But the big thing for me is that there's no support network there for people who have sexual attraction to children.
Yes.
They can't possibly, in any reasonable way, come forward and say, look, really sorry about this, but I fancy kids.
Do you know, I don't disagree with you. I don't.
Yeah.
But you will have your detractors saying you can't fix a paedophile. There is no fix for a paedophile.
I'm not suggesting that you can fix them. All I'm suggesting is that we have to accept that some people have sexual inclinations that are not good.
Mm-hmm.
But if we deal with it the right way, that they don't have to be bad.
Mm-hmm. The system's not working now.
No, I know that.
So we have to try something different. And you have to be a bit brave.
And this is not putting children at risk doing this.
Luckily, Eddie has recently been accepted onto a paedophile treatment program in Europe, where the help he'll get should ensure he controls his paedophilia. He hopes his decision to come out in this film will encourage others to do the same. Eddie hasn't been in touch with his mother for several years, and because he doesn't want her to find out about his paedophilia by seeing him on television, he's decided to write her a letter.
That's a really difficult letter to write to anybody, telling them that you are a paedophile, particularly when they will probably think the worst of you for the disclosure. But it's better than running away from it, which I have done. Dear Mum, there's no easy way for me to say this, so I just come out with it. I guess the word paedophile comes with a lot of baggage, so it will be difficult for you to read that this is a relevant description for me. It's not something I've ever wanted, and it's fair to say, I've only been aware of it since I was in my mid-20s. However, it's important for you to know that I've never had any sexual contact with a child, despite many opportunities. I honestly think I couldn't do it, and I don't want to do it. I concluded some time ago that all I can do as a result of my situation is to try and help others who are experiencing similar thoughts and feelings to what I've had and reduce sexual abuse of children in a meaningful way. All the best to you both, Eddie. I would like to think that she will be proud of me, just in a little way, for doing what I know is right.
Dr. Sarah Good has been a lone voice in Britain in her attempts to change our attitude towards paedophilia. And she believes she lost her job because she tried to understand paedophiles like Eddie. But she's convinced his example can give us hope for the future.
This is a key moment, really, in child protection when we're thinking about new approaches. And if we can encourage and support and help paedophiles not to begin offending and to continue their non-offending lifestyle so that no children are ever harmed by those particular paedophiles, that's fantastic.
I began this journey skeptical of Dr. Good's radical ideas, but now I'm convinced that we must use every possible method of stopping child sexual abuse, and that includes talking to paedophiles before they offend. If we don't, then in another 30 years, we'll be hearing from the generation of victims that was abused today. That's our children, and asking ourselves, why didn't we do more to help them at the time?
If you've been affected by the issues raised, there is support available online at channel4.com/paedophile next door. Next up, Gogglebox.